Welcome back. A spectacular piece of brutalist architecture. Looks like it was accidentally a whole load of seaborne containers that just were dropped here. So, what have we had today? It's been fireworks, particularly amongst the sprinters. Intermediate sprint points up for grabs, and indeed a green jersey as well. And so sailing through came Andre Greipel, tight in on the hoardings, and said, thank you very much. Peter Sagan says, what do you mean, thank you very much? You're going to have to fight harder than that if you want this green jersey at the end of the day. Mark Cavendish as well, just still underneath the 200 marker, a competition led now by Greipel by just 1 point, but there are more points up for grabs at the end of the day. King of the Mountains points have been apportioned as well. Just going through the day, the heat has been the main player, but also this, ouch, big hit for Jean-Christophe Perrault from AGU Tourlamondiale. He's bandaged, he's bruised, he's bloodied, but he's unbowed, and he's back in. He's tagged on to the back. Right now, the gap is 3 minutes. In fact, I'm just double-checking. Here we are. The gap right now is not 3 minutes. It's 2 minutes and 38. Hence my surprise. Tinkoff Saxo still pushing on. This is for Sagan. Sagan is up for it. He's livid. He's going to carry his adrenaline and maybe use it effectively. You can see dead centre of the road there. We have Movistar. And what is nice to see as well is Orica Greenedge getting busy. Will it be the Yateses? If it is, it will be Adam Yates, I suspect. But is Michael Matthews back and on good form? I think he might just be. And if he is, that is very good news for Aussie viewers. And it's very good news for the race as well. We always like to see Bling doing his thing. Big broad smile that he is. He carries a lot of jewellery with him, but not onto the road. John, we have, talking about smiles, we have our the name of the lady who often smiles and tells the time gap by the use, dexterously, of a chalkboard.
That's right, it's Time Gap Claire. Claire Pedrono is her name, and she hails from Brittany. She once rode on the La Grande Boucle, the women's race, and back in 2005, and now she finds herself doing what, as you correctly described, is one of the most important jobs on the tour.
Yes, indeed. Time Gap Claire. In fact, how did she get the job? She basically wrote and said, can I do that job? And they said, yeah, thanks for asking.
I'm joined by Stephen de Jong from the Tinkoff Saxo team. Stephen, how difficult was the decision to chase this breakaway with both Sagan and Contador on the team?
Well, I think before the start, we knew it was a good stage for Peter, so the decision was not that hard.
A lot of focus now on the green jersey with Peter as well.
Well, I think the key for the green jersey is in the next coming four stages. So that's where we try to get a nice gap of points.
And it's always good for Alberto staying at the front after the dramatic moments we just saw recently.
Oh, yeah, for sure. It's also important to stay in front in these stages and don't get caught in a crash.
There we are. Well, wise words, don't get yourself caught in a crash, but will these guys get caught? That's the question. With 33.7 to go, they've still got 2.5 minutes, Sean. When's 2.5 minutes going to be enough?
Well, they need to get to the 20 kilometres mark with at least 2.5 minutes. If it comes down from that, well, then I think it's going to be a very, very difficult one for them. We can see here the peloton, you know, there's a lot of movement in the peloton still. Tinkoff Saxo pushing on here, and I'm afraid for the breakaway with 33 kilometres with the run-in we have here, a very difficult one, warm conditions as well. It'll be natural that the six riders up front are going to get tired, even though there's a lot of very strong riders here in the breakaway, you know, real powerful ones. They're still going to start, I think, seeing the weaker ones here, some of them start getting into difficulty when they really start to go at 100%.
We're hearing that you're not hearing us very well at home, and we apologise for that. Apparently, it is to do with the heat that is rising here, and it's causing all kinds of problems with the microwave link. Are you hearing us okay, John, yourself, as you're back in Paris, as we're beaming to you first?
I am hearing you loud and clear. Very, very clear line to me.
All right, well, it may well be just our link with production. And those of you at home, if somebody wouldn't mind tweeting me and just saying loud and clear or Dalek or whatever it is that you're hearing, then we'll hear it, we'll get it firsthand. Here we are. The aforementioned Lamprey Merida. Is it possibly going to be the day when the pip squeaks? That's Pippo Pozzato. I put too many P's in there. Nice to see Orica Greenedge as well, Sean, joining the fun. That suggests that Matthews may well be up for it.
Yes, well, it's the first time we've seen Orica just coming to the frontier, but it tells us that they have interest as well. And, you know, when you look at Orica Greenedge, the team, you know, hugely unlucky in this tour, losing Simon Gerrans in the stage three. Albasini also, who's a rider for this sort of finish, he went out on stage five. Then Dalimpi, of course, are also out of the race. So there's, you know, there's three riders down, and that is going to make it difficult. But it's good to see. It just tells us that Michael Matthews is feeling better, and after what he's been through, because he's had some horrible days after the crash there. He suffered and battled through, and if he can just have a go for this stage, well, it will be good for today and for the days to come.
You can see the grimaces, and they're starting to look a little bit jaded, the guys who are in the break. I'm not surprised. It's been a long day in the heat, Sean. All credit to them, even if they do get caught.
Yes, well, I think to get into the break today wasn't too difficult. A lot of riders not really trying, because they were always talking about this, a transition stage, a stage for the sprinters. And I think a lot of the riders were saying, well, go into the break today, you know, a huge effort, and then the sprinters teams are going to control you out there all day, and you're going to pay for that in the days to come. But chapeau, they went out there, the six riders, and they have given it a good run. Maybe now, they can turn it on at 20 kilometres to go and try and hold on, but again, 2:10 is just dropping off all the time.
It is, inexorably, it seems. Thanks to everyone who's told us that you're hearing us loud and clear. Lovely Debbie Hill. Friend of this program, friend of this channel, down in Oz, says that everything is okay and everything far from okay with Andre Greipel.
Yes, it looks like that he is in difficulty, or is he just going back to the car? Doesn't look like that. I think we've seen it already in the previous climb where he was in difficulty, and again here starting to suffer. And the Pyrenees stages for a sprinter, when you have to do three big days in the Pyrenees and you come out of it and you have a day like today, a lumpy stage, Greipel is starting to suffer here.
Multiple wear of the green jersey during this Tour de France, and two stage wins for Andre Greipel. I think even if it stopped now, that would be as a majorly successful Tour de France. He, of course, now is hungry for more and would like to, of course, take on the Champs-Élysées and maybe win what is regarded widely, globally, as the Sprinters' World Championship, albeit, of course, the last stage of the Tour de France. 31.9 kilometres to go, 2 minutes and 7. Just starting to look like they're labouring ever so slightly, and Pierre-Luc Perrichon of Breton Sèche Environnemental at the back here is not looking overly delighted with life. Nathan Haas out of the saddle, bouncing for Cannondale Garmin. There's the local man from Francis Dijeux, just behind Thomas de Gendt in the red, who's been quite busy taking intermediate sprints and the biggest climb of the day. Genies himself, the local man, Alexander Genies, there in the white, blue, red, white, blue, blanc et rouge, indeed, of Francis Dijeux, having taken one of the intermediate climbs as well. And indeed, this is the last of the categorised climbs today. And it looks like any desire for a skirmish has been left some way behind on this road today, of which it's a long one, 198.5, and nice little bead on delivery there, as you see, job done. And it's nice to see fans here, albeit brought to the point of exhaustion, it seems, by the heat of the day. But lucky lad, he's in the shade. Wilco Kelderman took the only point available on that category four climb. And so they've got a little bit of a, let's discuss the terrain, shall we? They're going into a couple of bowls, so they'll dip down into one. You won't really notice too much about it. As Christophe Riblon going backwards. They will just take a little gentle roller coaster ride until about 14 kilometres to go. At 14 kilometres from home, that's when the day will be very, very high speed, I imagine. And we're going to get a proper junction now of the time gap between the peloton and those up the road. And there's a man who really is suffering. And even the gauze is not holding all of the crimson stuff, I'm afraid, for Jean-Christophe Perrault, who's taken a big hit today. He's been back to the medical car three times now. And dressings have been changed. And he's fighting to stay in touch with this race, Sean. He's a vital component within AG2R Le Mondial, even as a hurt rider.
Well, you would expect him to be, but in this tour, he hasn't been a great advantage to the team. I don't think he hasn't been doing much. At the beginning of this tour, he was the man finishing second last year on the podium to Nibali. There was big hope for him that he would do another place in general classification. I was always concerned to repeat a podium place would be difficult, but I did think, you know, a top 10, but he is a long ways off that form, as there's many other riders, and he's just back in the bunch, and that is something he needed to do, because he was, you know, a minute and 40 or something down there after his crash, to get back in the peloton here and stay in for as long as possible, and possibly in the end he will go out with some riders that will be dropping off, but he saved the day. Get through and see what the results show up, what the exams show up, if he's wounds. But another day through, and that's what the riders are doing who are really suffering. Just tick off the days as they go.
Welcome back. Andrew Court says loud and clear in Hong Kong. We've got people in Brunei, the United States. We're going global. Been a few complaints as well. Cliff Davies thinks we're speaking too much French. We're in France, Cliff. So just calm. 27 kilometres to go. I don't know. People want it all here. Some of you like a bit more French. A bit more pace, perhaps. Well, have some then. And here come Katusha. This is for Christoph, I'll be bound. And he's got a great chance today. Out front, it is Orica Greenedge, as you can see, on the nose of the chasing pack. Minute and 50. And the brake's starting to look doomed, Sean.
Yes, it's not looking good. 150 at the moment, and coming down all the time. And as we see there, the six breakaway, they start to be suffering the pulling faces a bit, and it's not surprising. And the peloton, just more teams starting to appear on the front of affairs, and that's not looking good for our break of the day.
No, it's not. We'll see how they go. Jenny is still up there, and here he is on the nose. Is he going to be minded to skip off? We'll see. For the time being, it must be tiring for them, especially the temperature that we've had, even though the man from France, Desjeux, just wipes his nose at the moment, almost you can see almost, well, very nervous, I imagine, on this approach. He's 26.1 kilometres from going home, essentially, and the gap is at 1 minute and 43. I just think that the breakaway might well actually reduce before it's finally caught, which looks inevitable at the moment, especially the amount of firepower that is on the chase down and Pipo. But Zarto is at least showing his hand. I wonder if he'll show his nose at the line. We'll see. He's in there. He's about 20th down at the moment, but it's in a pretty good position, not that far from Alejandro Valverde, who's a proper wheel to follow on a day like this. 25.7 kilometres then, not a great time to have any kind of issue, and the hand goes up, Sean, which always spells danger. It's Andrew Talansky who's asking for something.
Well, it's probably for the team car again. You know, just stock up on fresh bottles with 25k to go. We're coming to that 20k for the finish where it normally stops again. They might, you know, leave it go on a bit further today with the warm conditions. They have done that in this tour already in the beginning of stages where normally it's 50. They have reduced a number of days. After 30 kilometres, you can start taking bottles from the car. To be sure, you know, the riders, they're just going back and stock up before it's too late.
Nice bottle of Saint-Julien, nothing to do with that church, I was bound, John.
It's nothing to do with that church, you're quite right. This church is from 1471, and the belfry was built onto the church back then, and it's been added to over the years, and was part of the bishopric of Rodez for many years. It has a beautiful stained glass window, which unfortunately we couldn't see there, which has a symbol of the 12 tribes of Israel in it.
All 12?
All 12.
Big window. Maybe there were little tribes. Here we are then. all six of our breakaway riders have remained intact, then they've actually shared duty. Nobody leaning on anybody else, Sean. It's been equally shared, the burden, I think it's fair to say today.
Yes, well, they have been working extremely well together. All six are, you know, working good, and that always helps, because if you have one guy who starts to weak, he wants to stay on the rear, try and, you know, hang on as long as possible, and that upsets the rest. Everybody gets nervous with that, because you never know. Is he just playing the bluff and waiting, you know, to, you know, for the end to see can he go in an attack? So the longer the six can work together, but again, you know, when they have to start opening it, and Thomas de Gendt, I think, is the one who will start, you know, pushing on a bit. But 1:33 at the moment, still with 24k's to go. It's just going one way at the moment. That's down the way with the time advantage.
South African champion just at the back, Jacques Janssen van Rensburg. They do have an option, MTN Quebec. We had the lovely Douglas Ryder, team principal of MTN, in the commentary position earlier on. Getting ready to celebrate Mandela Day tomorrow, so they'll certainly be up for it tomorrow. They were up for it yesterday, of course, with Louis Meintjes. Finished top five, which is a fantastic result for them. In fact, Serge Pauwels the previous day finished fourth, so they're there or thereabouts. Will it be Eddie Bos today, Edvald Boasenhagen? Not quite sure. I don't think Eddie is overly fond of hot temperatures. I guess we'll see. Right now, here we go. This is a first hit out from the breakaway, thinking it is just getting too close, and it's a brave move, Sean.
Well, I don't know if we'd call it brave. To go at this time, you know, it's going to have a really... The chances for everybody here on the six-man breakaway, it's not the time to do it when it's coming down like that. You just keep on working, and if you're feeling good, you know, you just keep on contributing, maybe a little bit extra at times, try and get closer to the finish and then have a go. But with this distance, to, you know, to clip off on your own, it's not going to happen for Nathan Haas.
There we are. The Aussie's decided that he doesn't want to share this with any other Aussie, and there's a great possibility, of course, that Michael Matthews, Bling himself, is behind, and maybe that's extra added incentive. Who knows? The gap was coming down rather quickly, and he's just gone off here. Can he possibly hold on to this pace? It will be a long-range piece of glory if he manages to do it. Did take the Tour of Britain 3 years ago, we remind you. And can he just add to his impressive palmares again today? We'll see. 23.1 kilometres to go. It's a massively tall order, especially with a charging pack. And these guys, no response just yet. In fact, as we say it, suddenly we get one. And it's Cyril Gauthier that's decided to give chase. That'd be a handy pairing if they went for it, Sean. But you feel that their energy levels would be extraordinarily depleted after such a long day in this kind of heat, and still with just over 22 kilometres to go.
Well, they will be. And, you know, when you have a six-man group and they're still working well together, 1:30 of an advantage, you just continue on riding with everybody else. That would be, if I was the rider, if I was the team director, that would be my orders. I'd say just contribute with the rest, continue on working, and we will see. Because in this final, there's another bit of a hill to come, and of course the finish as well. If you're feeling good, you know, you have a great chance in this finish. You don't have to be maybe the fastest, it's the strongest, the fittest will survive. But if you attack the six-man group, well then, you know, to stay ahead of a big chasing peloton, it's always going to be more difficult.
Well, the winking wheat field bidding us farewell right now, and these guys, well, they're burying themselves. Look at Sagan. A few moments ago, he tore off a gel wrapper or whatever it was he was feeding himself, and he did it in such an aggressive fashion. It was just like he wanted those calories to bang in, and the attempt to bridge from the breakaway by Gauthier was very quickly nullified because of the pace that was picked up by the fellow breakaway riders. But it looks like the cadence that Nathan Haas is putting into the road right now, well, it's certainly impressive, but is it wise?
Very impressive, and you know, he is going at a real fast rate, because we can see the other five are chasing, you know, at a very strong rate as well. And we could see there that Gauthier, when Nathan Haas went in the attack, he just gave the signal that just continue on riding, guys, we keep on working as we have been all along, and just peg him back. And now we can see that the advantages, he has a nice advantage, but to keep it going on your own, that is always going to be the difficult one against five riders at the end of such a very energy sapping stage.
It's interesting. Gauthier just saying, come on, get on my back wheel. I feel like I've got a little bit of power here, and it's he that wants to maintain the chase. Doesn't want to do it on his own. And they're starting to work together. And Gauthier is the man that is cracking the whip hand here. He's essentially the road captain of this little tiny team time trialing team, albeit of different teams. And any alliance they form will be ripped up later on. We're under the 20 kilometres to go marker. And a minute and 44, Haas has found some great pace, and he's extended the gap on the peloton. But what about the gap to these guys? There he is up the road. They're working well, Sean, and in fact they're bridging over. And what it's meant is that we've suddenly had an injection of pace and a revitalized breakaway.
Yes, and we can see here that Nathan Haas is extremely strong for the moment. Can he keep that going for the next 19 kilometers and hold off the five chasers and hold off the main peloton as well? It's looking a little bit better for the peloton. 1:44 as we go inside the 20 kilometers to go. That is that's a good advantage. And if you work out the calculation, which we do, a minute per 10 kilometers, it's within that. Although this final is probably a one where you need a bit more, but we'll have to wait and see. Now the next 2-3 kilometers are going to be important for the five chasers. Will they be able to pull him back, or will he hold him off on his own?
Well, they can't shirk their responsibility, and it looks like he's knocked it back just a little bit. I think his own team, you can see him looking across the cut of the road, Sean. It does curve around the road, it does swerve around the bottom of this little basin that we're in at the moment, and so he had a good look back over his shoulder. He saw the pursuers, and I think he possibly knows the game is up, but it's been effective because now he can rest up, maybe go again. He's injected pace into this group. Maybe they've got a bit more belief as well. 1:46, the gap has just extended a little bit again back to the yellow jersey.
Well, I don't think he's going to be too popular with the other five.
Nope.
Attacking like this so far out, when you know the advantage that they have is going to be a difficult one to hold off. If you have 8 or 9 minutes here, well then it's open for all, you can go on the attack. But you know, the understanding, you know, between the six riders, you know they would be talking together. Okay, we'll keep on working together, and we'll see what the advantage is with, you know, inside the 10 kilometers to go. We will see now what will happen, and will he still contribute? He has to contribute the working here on the front. If he tries to sit around, well then there'll be definitely a discussion with the other riders.
Big discussion going on back to base as well from a rider from Bretagne-Seiche Environnemental. That's Pierre-Louis Perrichon. He was shaking his head. I don't think that was anything to do with the breakaway. And this is Gauthier saying, come on, for goodness sake. We can all do this together, but we can't do it alone. Now, let's just stop the bitterness and get on with it. De Gendt is the only one to respond to him at the moment. Some tired legs and the punishing heat of the day. The heat has ebbed. Has the demeanour of these guys suddenly in a little electric shock rode through this breakaway at the behest of Nathan Haas, this 26-year-old Australian. He sped off, and in fact it put a bit of punch back in them, and right now they hold a minute and 42 over the peloton. If they can hold on to this minute and 42 by the time we get under the 10k marker, it's that finely balanced at the moment. They've found some more pace, Sean. Maybe they believe, and maybe these guys are just getting a little bit disheartened. It's Tinkoff Saxo that are being required to do so much work, and Daniel Tekle-Hamanot has come up for MTN Quebec, former wearer of the polka dot jersey, that today is being nursed on behalf of Chris Froome by Joaquim Rodriguez, by the way, who was second in that competition. Chris Froome, of course, wearing the yellow jersey. It's busy, Sean.
Yes, it's very busy in the front. We can see the peloton, you know, travelling at 48 kilometres per hour. It's a little bit uphill here. That tells that there's a fast pace. 44 here for the breakaway. You know, depending on where they are on the road as well, you cannot really take too much from that. But the six, we can see it's coming down once again, 1:31. And I think there's some of the riders thinking here, just keep a little bit in reserve here. And it's just a tense moment here between the six at the moment.
Sign language, Gauthier, just putting a finger towards his temple. I think it was a visual expletive. Are you nuts? I think is what he was actually saying. And of course, the target for his ire was Nathan Haas. Nathan Haas, wearing number 163, nearest to us. In fact, he's at the back of this group, a group that he put a bit of pace back into. At least he did that for us sitting here at home. The rest of the breakaway group didn't like it. 16.7 kilometres to go. Minute and a half. When's that going to be enough, Sean?
Well, they have to have the minute and a half at 10 kilometres to go to have a chance holding on. We can see the peloton is just starting to up the pace, and if they can hold that 1:30 at 10 kilometres to go, well then they could put up a good battle to go all the way.
Let's see if they do it. Let's talk about the terrain that we're dealing with right now, Sean. In 2.3 kilometres time, they start a climb, a proper one. They're dealing with one at the moment, but it really will kick up. It's a bit like going over the ridge of a bowler hat, and they come back down into Rodez. Now they've got to deal, if you like, with the upturned rim of said hat to the line today. And it's the last 600 metres where there's 500 metres of what will be sheer hell at the end of 198.5 kilometres today.
Yes, it's going to be a real difficult finish here, and if the six riders happen to hold on and they have, you know, that 15-20 seconds coming into the final number of kilometres, you can lose that so quickly on the run in here. In the last 600 metres, you can lose 15-20 seconds very quickly if you have to, you know, give it your all 5-6 kilometres out with a peloton, you know, just travelling at much faster rate.
Looks like some kind of ceremony. I'm not sure whether it's time for evening vespers at the Abbey de Bonicombe. And in fact, these guys out here, I don't know, maybe a prayer. A wing and a prayer, perhaps. We'll see. Minute 23 is what they've got with 15.5 to go. And it just doesn't look like it's going to be enough. They're still fighting to cool themselves down, courtesy of the extra effort that's been demanded of them. And part of that is down to that man who's just sailing by right now, Nathan Haste, the Australian, who I think did everyone a favour today. He's kept this alive a bit longer, but the breakaway, his co-companions didn't like it. There's Tekla Hamanot, who's did a great job, of course, for MTM to wear the polka dot jersey with such honour. He is guiding in at the moment what looks like Tyler Farrar, and ultimately, I suspect, Norwegian champion Edvald Boasen-Hagen. Could be a great day for MTN Quebec, but then again, likewise for plenty of others. This man has had a very, very rough day, but he's holding on. How brave is that? I think you're looking at our Combativity Award winner by the end of today as an absolute certainty. 15 kilometres to go. Under the banner they go. Well, the green jersey points up for grabs as well, and how crucial is that going to be? First 15 finishes across the line will get points today. It's not an enhanced sprinter's points day. There are two more of those, so 30 up for grabs. 15 riders score points. There are the top five. 30, 25, 22, 19, 17. Will it be the breakaway that hoover up all those? Will Sagan come through? Don't think Greipel's going to be there. Sagan trails Greipel by a solitary point because Greipel nicked the minor points in the initial intermediate sprint. Sagan didn't like it, told him so, and in fact told his team to get up here because he quite fancies it today. Trouble is, so do plenty of others. Christoph of Team Katusha is in the mix, as you saw, just sailing by Tinkoff Saxo. It's busier, far busier at the front, and it's like cracking a whip hand over these guys. And one man who has really shown some scars today is Jean-Christophe Perrault for AG Tour Le Mondial. We wish him the best and indeed hope that his medical injuries aren't as serious as I suspected they were on his elbow, but he's still racing on. What a Trojan he is. Likewise, performance from the six men who are in the breakaway are 1:09, and the pace does not look overly focused, but it is. And look at these guys, they're wrestling with it. And bye-bye it is for British Environmental's Perrichon. Just can't keep up. Six become five, Sean. It's a battle of attrition.
Yes, and we can see it's Thomas de Gent who is pushing on up front. As we mentioned, when he gets into a breakaway, he just can be so powerful in the end and go on. And he's the one who will split the group here.
He is the one that's going to split the group, and I'm afraid that Genier's doesn't look like it's going to be a pleasant homecoming for him. He might relay back on in a moment. 14.1 kilometres to go, a minute and eight, and the attacks roll on, and it's that man again. Nathan Haas has decided he's going to go, and he's being joined here. Kelderman of Team Lotto Jumbo in the yellow goes with it as well, and there goes Coquard, goes Gauthier, I beg your pardon, it's Gauthier that shoots off as well. He was the one that was exclaiming, if you like, to Haas, and in fact it's Haas that's been beaten up here.
Yes, well, I think he's paying for his efforts a bit earlier because he did put in a big attack, and we can see Kelderman now with Gauthier following Thomas de Gendt. He will get back in. He will just keep on working at his pace. He's, you know, able to do that. He hasn't that extra explosive effort, but just powerfully can, you know, power along for a long, long time. And in a breakaway, we could see that he was the one in the earlier part of this little bit of an incline who caused the problems for the breakaway.
Cyril Gauthier hoping to do it for Europcar, a team that will be without a principal sponsor at the end of the season, unless they find one before then. There's the polka dot jersey on the back of Joaquim Rodriguez, who's been nursed home. I'm not surprised after his victory yesterday. He clearly left something on the mountain. I'm afraid it's not his kind of terrain today. It is about the punchers. Somebody's going to get beaten up. We'll find out who it is. Will Sagan be back in the green jersey? Certainly looks that way, because Greipel, who leads the competition right now by one solitary point after the intermediate sprint, has been distanced. So the six become three, and it's Kelderman here, it is Gauthier, and it is ominously Thomas de Gendt, who has got a significant victory, Grand Tour victory, of course, up the Stelvio in 2012 in the Giro d'Italia. So inclines aren't a problem for Thomas de Gendt. Cyril Gauthier and Wilco Kelderman, out of that trio, if they were to come to the line, it was between those three, who would be your choice, Sean?
Well, Kelderman looks very comfortable there. He seems to be the one who was riding there on the front with Gauthier on tow. Thomas de Gendt just claws his way back, as he can do so well. I think Gauthier could be, you know, the better one, a more puncher, but again, Kelderman looks a little bit too strong for the other three for me.
There we go, just picks it up, and in fact he's eyeing them, and I think they realise that actually he's the man that they don't want to nurse home. It's a difficult conundrum, Sean, how much effort to put in, especially if there's a rider that you fear here.
Yes, well, I think you have to keep on, you know, contributing. If one tries to, you know, get carried along, well then they'll just start getting unorganised, and that will allow some of the other riders to get back in once again. We can see Gauthier, you know, he is trying to just miss some turns on the front. Is it just thinking of spare a little bit of finish, spare as much as I can? He is a good finisher for this sort of finish, but Kelderman looks impressive, but with 12.5 things can change.
Drifts over Kelderman, the 24-year-old, fourth on the Dauphiné last year. It was a great year for him. Seventh in the Giro as well, we remind you. And he is here in the yellow and black. In the green is Cyril Gauthier, the 27-year-old Frenchman. He's pulling all kinds of faces. I wonder if they have a special little seminar led by Tommy Vogler, his teammate from the bad clown lexicon of faces. Who knows? Gauthier may well pull a few more before we get to the end today. Somebody's going to be smiling, though. Might be Thomas de Gendt, king of the mountains in the Paris-Nice, the 28-year-old Belgian. He can play when the road is an incline. They've got one right now. They're going to come over the peak of this. Then it's downhill into Rodez. It's quite a technical course, and I'm beginning to believe, Sean, it's a minute and two. They've got minute and three, just extending ever so slightly with 12.1 to go. It's a feisty trio, and I think that all of these three possibly have something left in the tank.
Well, I think they are the strongest of the breakaway. Kelderman looks to be that little bit stronger. We can see Thomas again still riding, and the rest I think is going to be difficult for him. There is an advantage here, as we see the peloton, you know, also coming into view. So I'm not sure if our time at the moment, 1 minute is the full minute, is coming down. But advantage for the three out in front. We have a number of kilometres downhill before we tackle the final run up to the finish here in Rodez.
Well, I'm just wondering whether Kelderman and de Gendt have done a oi midach, and they're just going to form this partnership, and I'm afraid get the better of Cyril Gauthier. He looks to be the one that's struggling at the moment, but you never know how much kidology is going on here. It's hard to read it, but 58 seconds it is. It's because we're on this incline, Sean, and the camera foreshortens the long road section. Once they peak it, there's this little squirrely helter-skelter into town, isn't there?
Yes, a very fast run into town, and that will help, of course, the breakaway, because they'll need every little bit of help possible. It is coming down, and I'm afraid, you know, with 11 kilometres to go, under the minute at the moment, that is going to be a difficult one unless they can really pull well together out front. But we see Gauthier, he's starting to miss his turn on the front, and that's not going to help because the other two, they're not going to commit at 100% with Ryder on tow.
Genier's just backing into the peloton right now. This is Jean-Christophe Perrault, who we saw take a really nasty tumble on not this kind of surface. It was a much more grippy surface, and it's ripped his elbow to pieces, I'm afraid. He's riding on. He will seek medical assistance proper at the end of the day. He had mobile assistance earlier, keeping it mobile and indeed animated this trio right now. Thomas again in the red, Gauthier in the green of Europe car, Wilco Kelderman in the yellow and black of Team Lotto Jumbo. 50 seconds now with 10.8 to go, and at least the more welcoming terrain is coming to them right now. And it's been a grind out there. And for those who've been a light parish on, have been out for much of the day, this will be not his greatest day, but I think one, if he doesn't feature high up on the results, he shakes his head. But I think he can take some sucker from it. And indeed, his team as well can actually be proud of him. It was a good effort by Perrichon, who's clearly, I think, probably outclassed by everyone else out there. This is Alexander Genies, the local man, and it's not going to be local joy for him, I'm afraid. Could it be a great day for any one of this trio? They've got the potential, they've got a chance, albeit a slim one right now. Will they be eaten up on the final climb of the day? That looks like it may well be on the menu, Sean.
Well, it's going to be a big ask for them to hold on out there, but again, you never know. Back in the peloton, we can see that it's Giant Albacin who are setting the pace. We can see Gene there, he's going through the town where he lives at the moment at 10.5 kilometres to go. He'll be disappointed that he was not able to make it with the front trio through his home village. Again, 48 seconds for the peloton, as we can see here. Ulrike Greenedge starting to contribute on the front also. So it all depends how many men from each team are going to, you know, push on in the final. But 47 seconds, it's going to be a real difficult one for our three leaders.
Yates brothers have been a factor, but they're doing the driving at the moment for Michael Matthews, who's up there. 10 kilometres to go, 46 seconds is the gap. Team Sky, of course, working to keep Chris Froome in a good place. As you mentioned earlier, Sean, he often features quite high up when it comes to a quick stage finish. And with that punchy climb, don't be surprised if he's not there, Chris Froome.
Well, I think if he's delivered to a position where he's very much on the front in the final couple of hundred metres, this run-up, the running will also suit Chris Froome because he is that explosive type.
9 kilometres to go. Chris Froome, is he getting greedy? He certainly was for time when he won up to La Pierre Saint-Martin, lunging the bike, you may remember, on that uphill climb. Every second counts as far as Froome's concerned, and he wouldn't mind a few more, quite frankly, today if it's on offer. Yes. Meanwhile, there's Nathan Haas, who really animated or reanimated the breakaway. Unfortunately for him, he's about to be caught, and it's a pack that's being led at the moment by MTN Quebeca, just followed by Giant Alpecin. And there, of course, you can see Sky behind Orica Greenedge. And Sky working for Chris Froome, and that magical moment will come when we pass the 3Ks to go marker. There is Tommy Vogler. Not in a happy place, I'm afraid, is our Tommy at the moment. And I think it may well be the last season we see Tommy. We'll see whether somebody picks it up, or indeed he up, whether he does move into the media, where he's expected to find a home very easily. Could see Vincenzo Nibali actually functioning very, very well. Had to work hard to get back on after a big split and indeed a puncture for him. That's the pace we've had today. Matching it at the moment is the yellow jersey on the back of Chris Froome, and almost as an eternal, it seems, his team nestled around him. It's a great cushion and comfort to the man. No comfort for anybody when you see the green jersey on the back of Peter Sagan up towards the fore. Huge punchy rider. What position will it be for him? And indeed, what finishing number will be attached to these guys? 7.7 kilometres, that's when we're going to find out. Jean-Christophe Perrault just being distanced right now. I wonder if it's going to be a combativity award for him, Sean, and I wonder if it's going to be bye-bye tour at the end of the day. He looked beaten up.
Certainly was beaten up. We could see there, you know, he hit the road very heavily, a lot of road rash on both elbows, down on his, I think it was his right hip. he's happy, I think, to get at this point with the peloton. Now he can just ride in at an easier pace, where he was in a real bad position at the crash with around 40 plus kilometres to go, 45 to go. He'll have to see what the damage is, but I don't think looking like there's anything broken, so that is always the first thing, the most important thing. I think he will continue, but we can see out in front here they're really pushing on. 6.8 to go, 33 seconds, and they're just on this flat section, and when they get to that 5 kilometers to go, it starts to go downhill, but the advantage I don't think is going to be enough for them to hold out there.
6.5 kilometres from home, they nearly accidentally, I think, got rid of Thomas de Gendt. They've reassembled themselves. Once we get to the 5 kilometres to go marker, we go around a roundabout, and then we hit the helter-skelter. You know who's up here? It's Pippo Pozzato, being guided into a into position, and indeed they have given the combativity award to Thomas de Gendt as part of the breakaway. I thought it may well be Jean-Christophe Perrault today. He of the injuries sustained on the road today, but it's de Gendt. At least he'll get something out of today, but he'd like an awful lot more, Sean.
Yes, well, I think they were all hoping to get a lot more, and it looked like that it wasn't going to be possible at all. Then, of course, with the attack from Nathan Haas, and that's the discussion as well. If Nathan Haas had not attacked and just kept on riding, they would have maybe another 10 or 15 seconds advantage. But the situation is as now, 30 seconds with just over 5 kilometres to go, and we can see a lot of movement here on the front of the peloton from a mixture of teams.
And Mark Cavendish is in the fray. Likewise, plenty of others as well. The Austrian champion, Marco Haller, is here, working for Alexander Kristoff. And so, tasty assembly of sprint talent. Now, let's see what we can do when we get off the bottom of this descent. Now, the temptation here is just to enjoy the ride. It would be on closed roads, not normally so. And they're about to tip down and into town. At least they'll have that and be out of sight. 27 seconds is the gap that they've gone. You can't quite see it at the moment, but the road is inclined down. It's a downward ramp. It gets to a very, very technical and proper descent, Sean, before they kick up. They're coming under the railway bridge in a few moments' time.
Yes, we can see they're just starting to go down gradually, and it gets more of a better downhill for the three out in front. We can see here they're still working very well together. 25 seconds at the moment. They need this run in to get a little bit of recovery before the final kick up to the finish here. The downhill section will allow them to recover a little bit, but they have to keep on pushing close to 100%, because with advantage 24 seconds at the moment.
Well, it's some sprint elite along with puncheurs who are out at the front at the moment, and some of you will be very pleased to see that Mark Cavendish is amongst this grouping right now. It's a drive into town. Sky guiding Chris Froome in as well. De Gendt, Gauthier and Kelderman, here they are, and they are about to take on the remainder of this descent. They've just come under this one here, the little road bridge. Kristoff looks in a very good position. He's got Haller, the Austrian champion, to guide him in. Having a teammate at a moment such as this, you might think vital, but it's how you ride everybody else's train, I guess. The green jersey of Sagan is staying very, very close to Kristoff. I suspect that is deliberate, Sean. Kristoff looks lively today.
Yes, well, I think Kristoff, we can see there's some of the Katusha riders hovering around the front, and Kristoff is there in that top 10, 15 places. We can see MTN and Quebec are the ones who are securing the pace on the front of the peloton, and that is Stephen Cummings at the moment. He's pulling the peloton along at a very fast pace, still coming down 19 seconds as we go to the 3 kilometres.
Well, would you believe that Radio Monte Carlo yesterday tipped actually Steve Cummings to take the day. Will he just squirrel off and do it himself? 19 seconds is the gap, 2.8 kilometres to go, and they're going to hit the base, and then it goes flat before we kick up just after the Flamme Rouge. 18 seconds, it's holding station. It's going to take a lot to get back because they've had this incline to deal with. Can they possibly make it? They've got to have their climbing heads on. We'll see if they do. De Gendt here in the red. This is Gauthier in the green of Europe Car, and of course Wilco Kelderman as well for Team Lotto Jumbo. And it's starting to fracture. It's not so much a chase as a reach out for glory further back. It's still Christophe that holds position though right now. Just looking at Peter Sagan, he's also in a terrific position as we sail in and start to take on what is a gentler flat section, almost a false downhill, and then we will kick up at the 600 meters to go marker. These guys are going to hit it first, but will they survive? 13 seconds is all they've got with 1.8 to go, Sean.
Yes, and we can see still Steve Cummins from MTM in Quebec on the front here with Nicolas Roach just on his wheel, a little bit ahead of the main part of the peloton. We can see those gaps appearing, and they're going at a real fast rate as Bulkan Mulema has a problem here.
Not a time to have it at all, and the Tekla Hamanot and indeed Van Rensburg, the South African champion, have done their job today. Here's Peter Sagan looming large, and they're all starting to look for this. Edvald Bosenhagen suddenly joins the fun. The Norwegian champion is in the mix for glory here today. Christoph, Sagan, Bosenhagen, three great puncheurs' names that must ring loud in the ears of these guys if they're on race radio. 1.2 kilometres to go, Sean.
And we can also see Michael Matthews there from Marika Green Edge in the top places on the front of the peloton. So it looks like he's the man who went through a very difficult time, looks to be going to challenge for this stage.
Will these guys possibly have their chance? Well, they've got one, but it's an extremely slim one. They go under the Flamme Rouge, and not that far behind come the chasing pack as well. It's sinuous, it's strung out. There's Sagan biding his time. Degenkolb's also in the mix here. A big gulp of air going into the lungs of Christophe as he wants some attention. And indeed, Mark Cavendish is coming up right now as well to join the fun. This is a real race for glory, and here is where the grind begins. You've got to be able to climb. You've got to be able to take it off. And there goes Peter Sagan. He's using his elbows and his shoulders. Still, the trio have at least some kind of hope, but I believe it's ebbing right now and may well just be dissolving as we hit this climb. It's a tough one, but De Gendt steps out of the saddle, back into it, and Kelderman goes. Is he bidding for glory? Gauthier gets on his tail as well. It's only 450, 500 metres of sheer pain and hell, and here come the pack right now, and they've got back in. They've got back in. It's Don Genier. Surely he's recovered at a moment such as this, and here comes somebody. It is Demar. Round him he goes, and there goes Peter Sagan as well. Big grind, lots of reserves being poured on right now. It is GVA. Can he give it? Can he make it? Van Avermaet hits the front. He's only guiding in, I think, Peter Sagan at the moment. It's not going to be second place again, surely, for Sagan. Here comes the line. It flattens off. It's all about the sprint. What have you got? It looks like it's going to be Van Avermaet. The line approaching. Can Sagan find something? Sagan. He just gets in on the wheel. He starts to draft. He thinks about going for the hoardings. He thinks about going wide. He thinks about glory. He thinks about a stage win. Can he possibly make it? No, he's denied once again. Oh, disaster for Sagan. Glory for BMC. What a finish that was. What a finish indeed. Total drama. Wow, Sean. What about that?
What about that? And looked like Sagan was in the perfect position. It was in the drafting. I thought he was just playing, keeping it all for very late. And in a finish like this, you can do that. But Van Avermaet, what an impressive. How powerful was he?
He had the power. He had the poise. He had the timing. And he has the stage. That is a very bitter pill for Peter Sagan. He extends his lead in the green jersey competition, but in the end, he was a couple of yards short. The man with the watts and the win is Greg Van Avermaet. What has Peter Sagan got to do to win a stage of this Tour de France? They keep asking him the question, Sean. He keeps finishing second. That's the fourth time in this tour.
Well, what a performance by Sagan, because he did everything perfectly, you know, followed Van Avermaet, but Van Avermaet was just on one of these super days. And when you come up against somebody who was on a super day, unfortunately for Peter Sagan, finishing second once again, Jan Bakelands in third, so two Belgians in the top three.
Tough day, punishing day, temperature as much as anything else, but supposed to be a transition day, but it was such a fantastic chapter of this great tour. Well, we'll be handing over to Ashley and Greg in a few moments' time, but stage 13, unlucky for some, not for Greg Van Avermaet.
Merci Damien, effectivement, eh bien, dans quelques minutes, nous aurons évidemment le podium protocolaire des marches du Tour avec de nombreuses personnalités hein, qui nous ont rejoint, Christian Pessèbre, maire de Rodez.
Hi there, welcome to Le Monde on Tour, following this extraordinary, explosive finish of this stage of the Tour de France. Greg Van Avermaet, who came on the show earlier on in the Tour de France, of course, has grabbed a fabulous victory. Greg Le Monde with me, obviously, as usual. And Greg, another great victory for BMC, but also really nice to see Greg Van Avermaet beating, unfortunately, Peter Sagan into second place yet again.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know how to say that, how to react, because Peter Sagan, I think he's been second almost every stage. Every stage he's gone after has been second. He's got to be disappointed. But
he should come on the show, then he'll win a stage.
I know. That's right. But Greg Van Avermaet was by far the strongest. Sagan couldn't come around him. I think Sagan's paying a little bit of a price for going after the points. I mean, he's been doing a lot of work from day one. But Greg Van Avermaet's victory was really good. But those guys in the breakaway, oh my gosh. Lucas Kelderman, I mean, what an amazing race. Those guys put it out. They're out there almost the whole race. I think they broke away about 12 Ks into the race. And I did not believe they could make it even that far. They came this close.
Yeah, they really did. Nearly 200 kilometers. They broke away after 12. That's 188 by my calculations. They stayed away minus about 200 meters. Let's show you what happened today.
So, a thrilling day on the Tour de France has come to a conclusion early on when they got underway just outside of Muret. It was De Gendt, along with that group of riders, who was leading the break. Six of them in total. And that breakaway, as we've just seen, very nearly holding on. At the intermediate sprint, it was André Greipel who put himself back into the green jersey, although Sagan would have the last word on that. Mark Cavendish in conversation here with Michał Kwiatkowski, who of course was involved in his own breakaway just 24 hours earlier. So these riders, Thomas De Gendt, Pierre-Luc Perrichon, Nathan Haas, Wilco Kelderman, Alexandre Genies and Cyril Gauthier fighting to get themselves clear of the main peloton, who at this point, with 64.8 Ks to go, were still 3.5 minutes behind. Not such a good day for Perrault of Agier Désert. Suffered a fall with 60 kilometers to go. He's been patched up. We'll find out later on whether he is going to continue the race or not. A disappointment for the man who was second to Vincenzo Nibali just a year ago. Well, plenty of French flags being waved, and many of them out in support of Alexandre Genies, who comes from Rodez. But Peter Sagan looking very, very pensive as they started to move towards the finish. Nathan Haas was the first from the group of six to try and drive it along and pull them clear of the ever-closing peloton. Then the turn at the front there of the Lotto Jumbo rider. De Gendt looking to try and produce some fireworks as he has done in the past on Grand Tours. These three struck out towards the end. The question was, were they going to be able to hold on? Wilco Kelderman, De Gendt and Gauthier being able to see the line, but then enveloped by the peloton. And it was Greg Van Avermaet of BMC who struck out. Peter Sagan with a great position on his tail, but just didn't quite have enough left in the tank to overhaul the Belgian, who crosses the line for his first ever Tour de France stage victory. An emotional moment for Greg Van Avermaet, with Peter Sagan coming home in second, which will ensure he maintains the green jersey.
Well, that really was an emotional moment for Greg Van Avermaet, Greg. And, of course, the guy won a stage at the Vuelta a España a little while ago, but a really, really fantastic pull to the line up, as we said before the stage, a very steep finish.
He's a very strong finisher. He's a really, really good classic rider. And, you know, he's got a great, I guess they call it punch. He held off a guy, Peter Sagan, which is a very, very good finisher. But I could say that when you're doing the racing for the green jersey like Peter Sagan's doing, that's a little bit of effort every single day that he's doing. There's a big psychological chase every sprint. I mean, he's going against Greipel halfway through every stage. So you could tell that fatigue was there. He came close, but Greg was, you know, he's incredibly strong. He's got a really strong team. And as far as BMC is concerned, they've been able to not have to control the race for the last 3 days. It's paying off.
It's paying off a little bit. Certainly, you're right. Tinkoff Saxo did much more work on the front of the peloton, it seemed. But a lot of people, as they were coming up the finish, those two, everyone thought, Sagan will come round Van Avermaet, no problem at all.
Yeah.
No. I mean, he's the guy with the punchy sprint.
Yeah, he had a great race, though. I mean, if you look at what he's been doing, I mean, he's been very aggressive from day one. And so you can't really, can't fault him for anything. I mean, Greg's a little bit fresher, really strong finisher. It was a very hard uphill. It's not just a 200, 300 meter punch, a sprint. It's 500-600 meters, and it's been a really hard day. This is a type of race for Greg Van Avermaet. He's very good at this type of stage.
Yeah, he certainly did very well towards the end, as you've seen. It was a fantastic holding off Peter Sagan. Let's go back, though, to halfway through the stage, Greg, and look at the intermediate sprint, because remember, we talked a lot about the green jersey today. Peter Sagan didn't get the points he was hoping for necessarily in that intermediate sprint, but let's examine it now with our slow-motion tracker. And, Greg, we can see, obviously, the breakaway is gone, but the points are still there for the guys at the front of the peloton, and our four main contenders, Cavendish, Sagan, Greipel, and Dekker Cobb, are all there.
Yeah, if you see that sprint starting, it's starting off from the right. That means the wind's coming off from the right. You can see how they all kind of move to the left. That's where you want to go if you're in the front. And Peter Sagan really got boxed in there. He had no place to go and wasn't successful in getting the points he wanted to. And got to remember, that's what his main goal was at the end of the stage today. It was to get more points, and always helps when you win the stage, there's more points. But, you know, he's been racing all out. He's going to get some real sprinters there, too. It's not just Greipel's one of the fastest guys in the world.
And not to forget, of course, there are fewer points for the intermediate sprint. So Sagan, actually, just by picking up a few, maybe he was just keeping himself, knowing Tinkoff were going to bring him to the end in order to get him more points.
And you saw Tinkoff riding in the front. They were distancing Greipel. They wanted to make sure he wasn't there at the finish. And I'm actually surprised that there was that big of a group. I actually thought it was going to be more explosive. There was a tailwind today, which helped the breakaway. So their tactic was to distance Greipel and put Peter in the right position to, go for the stage win, get as enough points as he can. He almost came close to the win, so he did a great race.
He did do a great race. Let's go and hear, though, right now from today's stage winner, Greg Van Avermaet.
I was really close. I went really early because in La Havre I was waiting too long, I think. And I would just try to go from almost from the bottom and... It was really long. The last 100 meters were keeping on forever. I saw there was somebody in my wheel, so I just kept on sprinting and I was hoping that he didn't come over anymore.
Je hebt er heel lang op gewacht, hè. Dit was een ritzege waar je enorm lang naar uitgekeken hebt. Vertel eens wat dit betekent voor jou.
Ja, het is niet gemakkelijk, hè. Een ritwin in de Tour. We hebben de ploegentijdrit dan gewonnen. En deze week was ik er altijd echt bij. Maar spijtig nog niet gewonnen. En dan deze week over de Pyreneeën overleefd. Met toch wel deze rit in gedachten. En als je dan kunt winnen, kun je beter dromen.
L'équipe vous a soutenu vraiment bien. Hein?
Oh, ouais, on a une bonne équipe.
On a, have a very good team.
J'ai trois étapes de vainqueur.
And to win the stage.
Un beau tour déjà.
It's very good. We've been doing well so far in this tour, and I think this is just a reflection of that performance that we put together.
Today's stage winner, Greg Van Avermaet. And while we were just watching that interview, Greg, you told me a good story. Why don't you tell everyone?
Well, I have an affinity for Greg Van Avermaet. I believe this is true, but he was named after me, and his parents brought Greg to my house when he was 6 months old. So he's also he's a great racer. I mean, he's been very active in almost every stage. And I love to see somebody ride and win when they've also been very aggressive. He hasn't quite pulled it off in the first 3-4 days, but it's great to see somebody win who's been really there too. It's not just coming out of the back of the pack. He's been in front and racing a great race.
Indeed it is. Great to have the Pope of cycling here with us as well. Yeah. Now let's move on to...
That's how old I am. I mean, he was 6 months old.
Let's move on to Tinkoff Saxo then, because Tinkoff Saxo today did a lot of work at the front of the peloton in order, obviously, not to let that breakaway go too far, Greg.
Yeah, I think they did a lot of good work for Sky. I mean, you know, it's actually, I mean, everybody has their interest in, sure. You know, for them, I think Michael Rogers said, you know, they can't do everything perfectly. I'm happy to hear that Contador is still optimistic for the GC, but their main goal is the green jersey, and that's their focus, and they did everything to control it. Got to say that they had a hard time pulling that breakaway back. I was amazed that it lasted this long. They're riding very well in front and a very fast clip. And I do think the tailwind helped him stay away to the finish.
I'm interested, you mentioned that Michael Rogers was on with us the other day. And of course, people will remember that he said, second is not impossible for Alberto. Did we see today real proof that they are in fact concentrating now on the green rather than the yellow?
No, I think they've been concentrating, kind of going for it since the beginning of the tour. But I mean, that's their backup plan, I'd say. I'm certain their priority has been and probably should be Alberto Contador for the overall GC, and I'm hoping he's not giving up hopes of first place. Not because I favor him over Chris Froome. I just want to see a battle. But, you know, I think they have to take it one day at a time. And, you know, it's been a hard race, and Peter Sagan's a more of a sure thing probably to win that than, say, Alberto Contador winning the Tour.
Absolutely. Okay, thank you, Greg, very much indeed. Well, as Greg was talking, I'm sure you could see the other guys from the Tinkoff Saxo team coming back to the bus. Let's have a look at the overall classification as it stands right now. No changes today. Chris Froome and TJ in the top two. It's 2 minutes 52 then, the gap to the BMC rider from Team Sky's leader. Then Nairo Quintana and Alejandro Valverde, both of Movistar, and Geraint Thomas, who we will have later on tonight in the studio for Tour de France today, is still in fifth. Okay, let's have a look at tomorrow's stage then now, and we can start that by showing you the profile of what we're expecting for the second transitional stage between the Pyrenees and the Alps.
So we start off from Rodez as the Tour moves in to stage 14. Rodez to Mende, 178.5 kilometres. An early Category 4 climb at the Côte du Pont de Salar. Then there's the sprint at Milo, famous for its aqueduct. Then a second category climb at the Côte de Sauveterre. A fourth category at the Côte de Chavritz. And an uphill finish at a Category 2 climb, the Côte de la Croix-Neuve, to finish off.
Okay, Greg, we've just seen the profile for tomorrow. What is your first impression of seeing that?
There's two races. One's going to be for the intermediate sprint, green jersey sprint, green jersey point. And I think it's going to be Greipel's going to do everything he can to stay there with the group and get some more points from Peter Sagan. And then it's going to be another finish like today. Could be a breakaway, could be a mass sprint like it ended up today, which I never predicted. But it'll be a little bit easier stage tomorrow than it is today.
Okay, thanks very much indeed, Greg. As I said before, Greg and I will be back for Tour de France today later on tonight. Today, though, it's a day for Greg Van Avermaet, his first Tour de France victory, and boy, did he work hard up that hill in the heat.
A first ever Tour de France stage victory, then, for Greg Van Avermaet. It is a very similar looking stage on stage 14, Rodez to Mende, as the Tour continues its transition between the Pyrenees and the Alps. 178.5 kilometres will be live from 13:45 CET. That's 12:45 in the UK. I'll break his ass.